Welcome to the MEP Academy. We're going to cover fan laws, how to calculate CFM, RPM, brake horsepower, and static pressure. So here's a fan chart. As you notice, if we have a certain model or we're looking for a certain CFM with a certain static pressure, this chart here has static pressure and capacity. So these are the static pressures along the top here. And then these are the CFMs going down the chart depending on which static pressure column you pick. So if you have a quarter inch static pressure and you're looking for 1,000 CFM, then this particular model will do that for you. So at a quarter inch, you can get 1,012 CFM. You can actually get 1,179 CFM. Now, the way they get more CFM using the same model, this is the same model, but this model will do 884 up to 1,179. How they do that is changing the speed of the fan, revolutions per minute, RPM. So at the smaller CFM, it's going slower. They speed the RPMs up, speed up the fan, they get more CFM at the same static pressure. Now, as you can see, as your static pressure goes up, going to the right here, for the same fan at the same speed, you start to lose CFM. Your flow, your CFM, is getting eaten up by this increase in static pressure. All right, so we can calculate RPM, brake horsepower, static pressure, or CFM with the following formulas. But before that, I want to show you again how these numbers change. If you know three of these values, you can determine the fourth. It's just a basic math formula. So if you're looking for a new condition on an existing fan, you can determine that by getting the values from the existing fan. So in this case here, I want to show you how you have static pressure over here on the left and CFM along the bottom. And you have your RPM, the speed of your fan, at 700 RPM. So that's a fixed curve for this particular fan. So if we had 0.25 quarter inches of static pressure, you would go along that quarter inch line until you hit the RPM line, and then you would go straight down from that point it intersects to see what your CFM would be. In this case, it says 10, but this chart is times 100, so that's 10 times 100. You would have 1,000 CFM. So at a quarter inch static pressure, 700 RPM, the speed of your fan, you're going to get 1,000 CFM. Now, what happens if the static pressure goes up and you have the same speed? What will happen to your CFM? Well, you can see that your CFM had dropped off. The same fan, you take a half inch static pressure. So the resistance in the duct, the resistance to the fan, to the motor, has increased. There's more static pressure. So let's say you had the same fan and you put smaller ductwork on it. That would increase the static pressure. Or you added a bunch more elbows. That would increase the static pressure. So with the same speed, if you left the speed of the fan alone, that increased static pressure would give you less CFM. In this case, it's just a little more than 600, not quite in the middle here, not quite 700. So your 1,000 CFM fan, same speed, more static pressure, is giving you less CFM. So you can see how problems occur out there in the field. You increase the resistance on the same fan, something happened to the ductwork, something happened to increase the static pressure, filters dirty, all kinds of things. Anything that increases the resistance on that fan It's still producing the same speed, but now you're getting less CFM. So now, if we can vary the RPM, we have different RPM curves for this same fan. I'm going to pick a different static pressure here for this example. So in this example, we have 0.4 inches of static pressure, and our speed, our RPM, is 650. That, where this line, the static pressure line, hits the curve for this RPM, straight down from there, tells us how much CFM we're going to get. So it's just a little over 600. So now what happens if we change the RPM? We increase the speed of the fan, but our static pressure stays the same. So you can see we increase the speed. So you're going to take that 0.4 inch static pressure. It's the same static pressure as the one we had before, but now we increase the speed. We're going to go to the next line of the column for the same fan, just going faster. Now we hit that line, and we're going to come straight down to see how much CFM we're going to get. So now we're getting over 800 CFM. So by increasing the speed of the fan, we're getting more CFM. So that particular fan will allow us to increase the RPM. So if we did it one more time to the 750 RPM line, same static pressure is not changing, we're just changing the speed of the fan, and we're noticing the results of the CFM. Change the RPM, make it go faster, get more CFM. So you can see here, line three, the third line here, we started at a little over 600 CFM. At 650 RPM, we increased it to 750 RPM. Now we're getting 1,000 CFM. So with these formulas here, you can determine any one of those items that we just looked at on the chart. So in this example here, we're going to say CFM 1 is 2,000. The speed is 1,000, but we want to get at least 2,200 CFM. So all you do is put these values. We have three known values. We know the existing CFM because we've measured it. We know the existing speed of the fan because we've also measured it. We know what CFM we want. And so all it is from there is a calculation. So we put the values in because we're looking for the new speed. What speed does that fan have to be to get the new CFM that we want? So the good way to remember this is 2 is new, 1 is old. 2 new, 1 old. So 2 is always the new number you're looking for. 1 is the old number or the existing number. 2 new, 1 old. Just a little mnemonic to help you remember what is new, the new number, and what is the old number. So in this case, we had 1,000 RPM existing, RPM 1. CFM 2 is the new CFM we're looking for. CFM 1 is the old existing CFM. You just do that calculation, and to get the CFM we want, we need to speed the fan up to 1100 RPM. CFM 2. So just using the same values, moving it around. If we knew that we didn't know what the CFM was and we were just speeding up the motor, you really wouldn't do it this way. You would do it the other way. You would determine what speed you need. But the formula works any way you want. So CFM old or CFM new equals CFM old or existing times the new speed over the old speed, existing speed, will tell you how much CFM new you're going to get. Same numbers. Now with static pressure. So with static pressure, it's a little different. Now you're dealing with square root of the static pressure new over the old. So just work these numbers out, pause the video, work these formulas, look at the formula, and practice them. They're pretty simple. In this case, the 2000 CFM of existing, and let's say we're increasing the static pressure to 0.605 over the existing static pressure would tell us that you would have 2200 CFM. So just work these formulas out. They're the same numbers. You're just moving them around, practicing. In this case, this CFM is based on brake horsepower. So when you change either one of those, you're going to get a new value. It all depends what you're looking for, what you're trying to solve. So in this case, we're trying to solve for the new CFM. And we're using the same values we used before, the 2000 CFM existing, and coming up with 2200 CFM new by changing the brake horsepower here. So as you see, we increase the brake horsepower in order to get more CFM. Okay, here's the last two calculations for brake horsepower using CFM. So the new brake horsepower, what is it going to be? Here's the example or sample to use. So brake horsepower one, the existing, let's say it's a 3/4 horsepower. Existing CFM is 2000. And once again, we're using the 2200 CFM for new. So two is new, one is old, or one is existing. So to get the new brake horsepower, you got the existing 3/4 horsepower times new CFM divided by existing CFM cubed. So when you put all those in, you get 0.99825 brake horsepower for your new horsepower. And static pressure, same thing. To get the new static pressure, you use the existing static pressure times your new CFM over your old CFM squared. So once again, put all those values in, do the calculation, and you get a 0.605. So the best thing to do is to practice these calculations or to refer back to them if you're trying to figure out any one of these variables. It's pretty simple after you've done it a few times. So we hope you learned something here today, and we will cover additional engineering formulas in upcoming videos. So be sure to subscribe if you're looking to learn more about engineering.